Hello, it's Michael Eckhardt from Quantisana TV Spezial, and I like to introduce you today a very special guest. Who is it? Have a look, please. And who is it? Laura Chaplin, here on my side. You're very welcome in our television channel.
Thank you. Thank you, Michael.
And it's a very big pleasure for us.
Pleasure for me too. Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome. So who is Laura Chaplin?
Laura Chaplin is a creative person, somebody who expresses herself through her art, an artist, a painter, a designer, an author. I think that pretty much sums it up. It's kind of vast, but I love to be creative. I'm very inspired. I have a big heritage from my grandfather, Charlie Chaplin, who inspires me daily, who's left a philosophy of through me, who I feel like I need to continue.
Okay. Yeah. Nice. And very successful?
Yes. I've been, I do a lot of exhibitions all over the place. I'm holding also a lot of events. I participate in a lot of humor seminars.
Okay.
So yeah, you can discover a lot of my creativeness also through my watches, through jewelry, through some clothes designs, and through wines.
Okay. Also artist and designer, is this compatible?
Yes, definitely. Yeah. I think every designer is an artist somewhere along the line. You have to be creative. You have to get it down on paper first before you can actually create your design. So I think that they definitely have a lot in common.
Okay. And how about you? When you start to be a creative person, in which time or which age do you start?
I've been creative ever since I can remember. I've been painting and drawing. I grew up in the Manoir de Bon, which is now Chaplin's World, my grandfather's last home in Vevey. And I used to draw drawings of him, sketches, and then I would sell them to all the guests who would come by for 2 francs, 5 francs.
Okay.
And it's always been my main subjects, my grandfather horses and lady silhouettes. And it just continued, and it's always stuck. It's something that I've always been passionate about, that I've felt a need to do. And today I'm very fortunate to keep doing it.
Okay. And how about the houses where you grow up in Montreux?
Corbusier above Vevey, and it's a place I like to call paradise.
Okay.
It's the my grandfather's home for the last 25 years of his life.
Okay.
I grew up there till I was 16, and it's I mean, it's just a beautiful place, beautiful trees, beautiful house. It's magical. I highly recommend to go visit.
Okay. Now, is it actual the museum from Charlie Chaplin?
Yeah, so today it's a museum that's in tribute to Charlie Chaplin. We can go through the house of see more of his private life and how he lived with his family. We've left a lot of furniture, and the house has kind of stayed as it was. Yeah. And then there is the new building, which is the studio, and there we go into his work, into his creative artistic input and his films.
Okay, yeah, that's nice. So maybe we can have there also together interview, and maybe you show us there something in this house, or you explain us more of the family life from the family Chaplin. This is maybe interesting for our television guests. So, and then you grow up there, and you study there in the area, or?
I grew up until I was 16, then I moved to London. I did some studies in London, and then when I was 21, I came back to Switzerland, and I continued some fashion design studies.
Okay.
And started to do painting. I did a painting for my mother for her 50th birthday, and a friend came over and saw the painting and said, "Oh, it's really good. You should do more painting." And I don't know, maybe. And she ended up going to this gallery that just opened in Montreux, and spoke to her and said, "Oh, my friend's a really good artist. You should maybe do something with her." So then she contacted me, and I went to see the gallery. It was a beautiful gallery. And from then on, we booked a date. A year later, I painted about 60 paintings in a year. Did a vernissage. It was a huge success. And since then, I haven't stopped.
Okay, that's nice. Perfect. Yeah. And your clothes collection, you continue to be, you work in the clothes collection or to be designer? For clothes now, actually,
I have a fashion design diploma. I have already lots of sketches and designs and my ideas. Now it's still in very beginning phases.
Okay.
But the idea is to get a clothes collection out there, and I mean, I have so many ideas. It's we just have to see how it goes.
So you're unstoppable. No?
Maybe. Yeah, with my creative input, I'm unstoppable, yeah.
Okay, good. So, and you have also more projects now? Actually, you talk about your watches?
Yeah, I have my watches. So these are limited edition watches. There are 20 a piece. It's art, my artwork that has been reproduced onto the watches.
Okay.
And I'm very happy with these. I've also done some. I'm very philanthropic in the things I do. Also, I like to contribute and give back. Maybe it's in my DNA. I don't know, but I am godmother to a foundation in the Valais in Switzerland, which helps kids in Colombia.
Okay.
And
what is the name from the?
Moi pour toi.
Moi pour toi.
Fondation Moi pour toi.
Okay.
And I got invited to go out there and see the kids, and I painted with them. We had some artistic exchanges. We watched some Chaplin films. They even did a little theater show on the film the film The Kid for my grandfather. And from that moment on, I couldn't refuse but to engage and help this foundation. And it was also a huge revelation for me.
Okay.
And into writing this book, which is called Laughter is the First Step to Happiness.
Okay.
And it kind of started, yes, through this foundation. I always knew through my grandfather, who said it so well, a day without laughter is a day wasted. And I've truly believed in it. And going out there, seeing these kids who had nothing and who had just a huge joy for life and the most beautiful smiles.
Okay.
It brought me so much well-being that I realized that a smile has no cost. A smile is free, and it brings us a lot of good. And so I started to dig, and from my research, I decided to write this book. And it's an easy read. It talks about different chapters of how the effects on our health, on our what we can do in our diets to improve our moods.
Okay.
How people have healed themselves through laughter. I've met doctors. I've met. There's so many different tips and ideas of how to improve your mood through laughter and improve your health.
Okay, no, that's nice. Do you have some text for our guests? So
yes, I can read you a few.
That's very interesting, and this shows you how positive you are. You know.
Yeah, I can read you a short text, or I can read you the prologue. What you prefer?
No, how you want.
Yeah?
You can. Yeah, the text.
Okay. Well, I'll start with explaining to you what are the benefits of laughter.
Okay.
Because laughter is a part of human behavior regulated by our brain,
mm-hmm.
helping humans clarify their intentions in social interaction and providing an emotional context to conversations. Laughter is used as a signal for being part of a group.
Yeah.
It signals acceptance and positive interaction with others. Laughing is a celebration of the good, and it's also how to deal with the bad. Laughing like crying is a good way of eliminating our toxins from our body. Since the mind and body are connected, you use an amazing amount of muscles when you laugh. So it's a great exercise.
Yeah.
Laughter is the best medicine. We're always being told that. But there's actually more good to giggle than just raising our spirits for a couple of minutes. In fact, laughter is a big deal.
Yeah.
And has been shown to have many beneficial effects on human body and in different ways. So here are 10 health benefits of laughter. One, laughter will help you live longer. They also say it is a great facelift. It fills our body with endorphins, which help also boost our immune system, that's
okay.
Number two.
Yeah.
And help fight off illnesses.
Okay.
It can also relieve pain for people who, it's been proven, there's been studies that have been shown that through laughter we can, relieve pain.
Yeah. No, I believe this, yeah.
Number four, it reduces depression.
Yeah.
Number five, it can boost your relationship.
Okay.
Six, there is social benefits of laughter. People who have a sense of humor and generally have more friends.
Okay, yeah.
Number seven, it's an internal workout. You burn calories, you use almost every muscle in your body when you laugh, so it's a great workout. It burns calories.
Okay.
It improves your breathing because of your lungs. You inhale a lot of air and it will strengthen your lungs and bring in great oxygen and improve your breathing.
Okay.
It can help you lose weight because you are burning calories. And last but not least, it protects your heart.
Okay. Yeah, that's very nice.
So
and very interesting.
Yes, there are so many amazing benefits on laughter. My grandfather was a perfect example for me. I meet people in the streets. I meet people every day and they say to me, "Oh, your grandfather, he was our light and our moments of joy in front of the TV, and through our hard times, we at least had your grandfather who made us laugh."
Okay.
And I think he knew it. He knew how to take difficult situations and turn them into something that we could laugh about and make silly things seem unimportant. I've had the proof since I was a child, and I want to continue. And I think in times like today, where people are stressed, under a lot of pressure, people just need reminding to take 5-10 minutes just to laugh and even laugh at yourself or with your friends or watch a movie.
That's a very good secret of life. No, not only.
Yeah.
A philosophy, this can be a good secret of life, you know, when you laugh.
Definitely.
And you attract many people.
There is so many positive effects with
laughter. Yeah. And how about your grandfather? I mean, now we are in a generation with the young kids. Nobody knows anymore Charlie Chaplin. You can explain us a little bit about Charlie Chaplin, your grandfather. I mean, in my generation, everybody knows it, but now the Facebook generation from now and the Twitter generation don't know nothing about him. But explain us a little bit about Charlie Chaplin.
Well, my grandfather was one of the only men on this world, artists on this world, to have produced, acted, directed. He wrote all the music to his films. He basically did everything from A to Z with his movies. He came on the screen as a tramp, as something that was also never seen before. He took important situations, and all his films have a very, very important message, a message for humanity.
Okay.
And he was just a little genius. Yeah, but somebody who was very disciplined, who came from a very poor background, and who fought hard, who believed in himself and believed in the people.
Okay, and when he started his film career, his slapsticks, and in which year?
He started when he was about, his first movies started in when he was in his 20s, early 20s. Mm-hmm. But he really started to take off when he got to Los Angeles, and that's where he really started to take off. He started off in a lot of theaters, working in numerous theaters with the Carno Group, and then he then went into film, and it really took off. I think he was around 23 years old.
And do you remember also some famous films from him, so titles? Maybe this is now good for the guests here that they can Google in.
I'll give you a few of my favorite films.
Yeah.
Would be The Kid for the emotional side, City Lights for the romantic side.
Okay.
The Great Dictator for its power.
Yeah.
I would go for those three: The Great Dictator, The Kid, and City Lights. And why not The Circus also? Okay. Let's add that one on.
And The Great Dictator was so a film about politics, no?
Yes.
But in a slapstick way.
Yes.
Yeah, not
it's
so.
It's a satire comedy.
Okay.
That talks about basically it's about Hitler and all the terrible things that he was doing. He was a visionary. He kind of guessed where this was going, where his time was going, what was going on. Yeah. And he decided to make a film about it. It caused him a lot of trouble. But it was definitely well worth it. One of the best films ever.
Okay.
If you ask me.
Yeah. So, and you have also some good things about your grandfather, what you remember very well, or what you like from him, you know, maybe you have there some.
I never got to meet my grandfather. I came 10 years too late.
Yeah.
I knew my grandmother very well, but not my grandfather. I wish I did. I would have had so many questions to ask him. He left so many memories and so many amazing things for me to treasure and to take example from. And I think, like him, today I want to make people smile. I want to make people happier. And I try and do that through my own artistic input, whether it's through writing a book or through my art. I mean, every single piece of my art is to deliver a good emotion, a good message, a positive message. And I hope that everybody who comes to my exhibitions or who gets involved in my or sees my creative aspects will leave with a big smile.
Okay, that's nice. And how difficult is it for you to work with such famous name, Chaplin? Is it easy or not so easy?
I think it has both sides. You can have it as something that's positive because it attracts attention.
Yeah.
People are intrigued, and then the negative side is that there's very high expectations. My grandfather, I mean, he's way up there, and people come with a bit of prejudice, and they kind of expect certain things from you. And at the end of the day, I'm me, and my grandfather was my grandfather.
Okay.
We're not the same person, but I mean, for me, it's an amazing chance and privilege, without a doubt.
Okay, and in your family are many worldwide known actors also, no? Maybe you can tell us there something. Why is this not only Charlie Chaplin? There is a lot of.
We are a lot. My grandfather had 8 children.
Yeah.
With my grandmother, and excuse me. I have about 30 cousins.
Okay.
So there is a lot of us. A few took to cinema. I have my aunt Geraldine, who did very well.
Uh-huh.
Her daughter Una, my cousin Una, is also doing quite well in cinema. I have my sister who did a lot of modeling. I have a brother who's in music. My dad's into circus. He's a sound engineer, and he works a lot with circuses. So I would say we all kind of have that artistic gene.
And very successful. Very successful. Yeah.
I don't like to say it.
No, please say it. Very successful.
But we try our best.
Okay. Yeah, that's fine. Okay. So,
Otherwise, I can talk to you about my art, what I do, my main subjects. I paint, so my 3 main subjects are my grandfather, which is Charlie Chaplin, who I paint pop art and classic.
Yeah.
I usually don't really have an idea at the beginning of how my art piece is going to end up. I just let myself loose, and I just it just kind of reveals itself as I go along. And
okay.
So I don't usually have a picture as a reference. I'll have an idea of the shape or what kind of emotion I want to bring across.
Okay.
And then I just bit by bit it kind of reveals itself until I finally see it and say, it's done. So then there is my grandfather, who I do pop art and classic black and white, who I love to discover. It's kind of my way to have that relationship that I never got to have with him, and discover him through my own eyes and my own ideas. Then I have lady silhouettes, which I paint a lot just with my fingers.
Yeah.
That allows me to be a bit more messy and more spontaneous, and it makes quite a unique piece because I use all fingers, both hands, and I wouldn't remember where I started, which finger, what, where. So it's quite fun doing that, and it's a bit my fashion side. A lady silhouette is something that I've been able to draw very easily, and that's always inspired me. And then the third theme is horses, a lot of zebras also. The horses is, I'm a horse rider, I do a bit of competing and show jumping, and I all started back in the manoir. We had 3 little Shetland ponies in the garden.
Okay.
And that stuck with me my whole life also. And the zebras, I love the black and white contrast, and I feel like each zebra has its own fingerprint. You never have 2 zebras with the same stripes.
Okay.
So I think it kind of tells its story on its own also.
So with your horses, this is more your hobby, no?
Yes.
I guess.
Yeah.
But you are 24 hours online, so this means you have not so many time for hobbies.
No, I have to get up early.
Okay.
I get up early. I usually get up early and go horse riding, but it's not always easy to fit everything in.
Yeah. Okay. So, and you have also a small dog at home?
Yes, I have. I'm an animal lover. I grew up with a lot of animals at the manoir, and I have 3 little dogs at home. I have 2 horses and some chickens.
Okay, so this is your 24 hours for me. This is your 24 hour job. Okay, so, and what are your next projects this year, coming year, next 10 years?
So, I have an exhibition that's starting today.
Yeah, okay.
In Zurich. I'm very excited about. I have about 15 paintings that I'm showing at this exhibition of my three themes. You will also find my watches, my book, and my jewelry. And this exhibition will last for a month. It's at the Gallery WBB. And you can find more information also on my website, laurachaplin.com. Mm-hmm. And this exhibition will go on until the 8th of July. And now I'm excited. It's first in Zurich for me.
Okay, yeah, that's a nice place, you know. So you have a short message for our guests? What do you like to say? You have some messages, I think. So you are the person who have a message for the peoples.
What I'd like to say is never forget to smile. As my grandfather said, a day without laughter is a day wasted. And I encourage you to support me and my book. We have put together a petition to collect as many signatures as possible to make laughter a human right, which is not the case today. You can find more information on charliesmile.org.
So, what's very nice. So, this is Michael Eckhart from the Quantisana TV, and we see us in the next time again here in our channel. And thank you very much, Laura Chaplin, to being with us.
Thank you so much for having me.
Yeah, bye.